What's up, guys? I've been doing this new, hopefully new tradition with my friend Alex, my good friend Alex, where I've been going over to his house and we've been listening to records and playing Magic, the Gathering. I've been getting back into Magic and he's been getting back into record collecting. And he used to play Magic, you know, when he was a kid, and so he knows how. And so he's like, bring decks, and we can play. I don't want to buy cards, but, you know. So, records, Magic, good times. So we've been doing that. So we've been listening to records, and I was like, I should do another record roulette. That would be fun. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to just pull up my Discogs here and hit spin and see what we get, and I will tell you my feelings about it. All right, first up, we've got a pretty much Stone Cold classic, as far as I'm concerned. It's Christmas in the Stars, the Star Wars Christmas album, featuring the original cast, R2-D2, and Anthony Daniels as C-3PO, down here at the bottom. So, this is, dog shit, I would say. This is songs from the Star Wars Christmas special and additional things, and it's pretty horrendous. I found this at a Goodwill maybe 8 or 9 years ago. Same time I found this at Goodwill, found Combat Rock by The Clash at the same Goodwill. I like to think that those came from the same collection. This does have the all-time classic song, What Do You Get a Wookiee for Christmas When He Already Owns a Comb? How can you go wrong with that? This is a pretty rare record. It sells for around $45-$50 on Discogs, actually. So good steal. I got it for $1. I wouldn't recommend going out and buying a copy of it, but you can hear this fine recording on YouTube and whatnot, and so it's probably worth one listen. It's definitely a fun thing to own that you can pull out once a year during the Yuletide season and throw on for a good old chuckle.
Let me see. We have a scarf for Skywalker, right?
Yes.
And perfume for the princess?
Yes, yep.
What about Han Solo?
Couldn't we get him here?
That leaves one big problem.
The Wookiee.
Couldn't we get him a comb?
We gave him a comb last year.
What can you get a Wookiee for Christmas when he already owns a comb? What can you get in a hurry for a furry kind of friend like that?
Next, we have the second album by legendary Minneapolis noise rock band Cows. It's Daddy Has a Tail. This is their sophomore album. I'm mostly familiar with, most people are mostly familiar with their most popular album, which is their fifth album, Cunning Stunts, which I do also have on vinyl. That one's from 92. Daddy Has a Tail here came out in 1989. This is a 2016 repressing. It's on yellow to match the cover. The record label Amphetamine Reptile Records, which has been around for a long time, since the 90s, and currently lives here in Minneapolis. They started reissuing all of Cow's records on vinyl in 2016, 5 years ago. And so I have this pressing of Daddy Has a Tail, and then I also have a repressing of Cunning Stunts. And Cow's rule. They're amazing, you know. If you like noise rock, you really should listen to Cow's. I have always kind of felt, like, sad because, you know, the Minneapolis discourse does not give love to Cows. You know, people talk about the legendary music of the Twin Cities and like Dylan and Prince are the obvious ones, and then people will talk about Hooskers and the Mats, and then Soul Asylum, you know, Semisonic, I guess. And that's kind of it, you know. Lizzo, I guess. I don't think she counts. I don't think she should count, personally. But people don't give love to cows. What's the deal? Gotta give love to cows. I hope to pick up more of these cows represses in the near future, like Sexy Pea Story and other great albums that I would love to have in my collection. We've got more noise rock. It is AIDS Wolf with their final studio album, Ma Vie Banale Avant-Garde. So AIDS Wolf is like a sort of no-wave noise rock kind of band that was active from like 2003 to 2012. This record came out in 2011 and it ended up being their final album. They're from Canada. Fun fact, this album was recorded at Dub Narcotic in Olympia, Washington, the studio owned by Calvin Johnson and K Records, where many albums have been recorded, including The Glow Part 2 by The Microphones, and many other classics of the Olympia scene and beyond have been recorded at that studio. This album is pretty good. It's not like gonna change your life, maybe, but it's definitely solid. Haven't listened to it as much as I probably should have, but I like AIDS Wolf. I have a couple of their albums. The other album by them I have is called Cities of Glass, which came out in 2008, and both of them I found at record stores just like used for under $10, and so I picked them up because they were cheap. And if you like noise rock, no wave, you know, early Swans, early Sonic Youth, early Boredoms, stuff like that, you might want to check this out. It's pretty good. Up next is a Stone Cold classic, I gotta say. It's Black Market Clash by The Clash. So this was an EP that only came out in North America in 1980. So in between London Calling and Sandinista. But it consisted of recordings, B-sides and single stuff that had not been released outside of the UK between like 1977 and 1980, so like during the span of those first three Clash records. This is it's an EP. It's a compilation, really, of just B-sides from those early years of The Clash. And, you know, what can you say about The Clash other than that they are just one of the best bands of all time? And, yeah, like, this has got some pretty good bangers on it. Capital Radio 1, right out the gate from 1977, you know, that's, doesn't get much better than that, I don't think. So, I'll probably play a clip of it right now. Next, funny that this got picked. So I've talked about this album before on this channel, just made passing reference to it being amongst my favorites, and I also talked more in depth about it, I'm pretty sure, on my video about the music 4chan likes, MuCore. And when I felt strongly about having favorites of things, like a definitive number one, this was it, most recently, up until the point where I decided that I just didn't really want to try and have the worry about what I liked the most, and if I liked something more than something else, and if that mattered or not, just kind of quit caring, but suffice it to say that there was a time that this was my favorite album of all time. It's Death Consciousness by Have a Nice Life from 2008. It's got the zine in there as well. And so this zine is actually really cool. It's pretty long. I think it's got page numbers in it, does it? It does not. I think it's like around 100 pages, almost. 60 to 100 pages. It's pretty long. And so Dan Barrett, who is one of the two members of Have a Nice Life, and he's the singer, he wrote this zine that is... He was a history major in college. And so this whole zine is about the history of this figure named Antiochus and the history of Antiochianism and how his philosophies and religious texts informed the creation of this album. And it's like a scholarly piece that is written in like a paper, you know, and it's got a bunch of you know, heavily quoted, you know, poetry by Antiochus, and you've got some like illustrations and things, and it's told in 7 chapters and kind of goes into like all the different ways that it mirrors the tone and content of the album. The album is a double album, and each of the halves has its own name. The first disc is called The Plow That Broke the Plains, and the second disc is simply titled The Future. And so you learn all about Antiochus and all of these interesting things that he did and said, except the thing is that Antiochus is not real. Antiochus is fictional, and Dan Barrett created him and made him up and wrote this whole thing himself, and it's pretty wild and cool and really deepens the experience of the album when you take it all in. Really good album. And then Dan Barrett, he released an album, a solo album, under the name Giles Corey, which was also a weird concept album that came with a book, a bound book, not just a zine, that was about the history of this sort of occultist spiritual figure named Robert Vorre and his sort of cult that he led, and then these machines, including the Vorre head device. There was this sort of hood that you would wear that would induce seizures and epileptic visions, and Dan Barrett's like this period where he was like gonna commit suicide, and then he started experimenting with the Vorre head device, and all these recordings like came out from that and all this stuff. And again, Robert Vorre, made up, not a real person, like super, super interesting. Dan Barrett is a super cool, interesting, compelling guy whose art I really, really, really love a lot. And yeah, this album is just incredible, and it's so, like, there's nothing else like it, because there's some shoegaze on here, there's some post rock, there's some folk singer-songwriter, there's like almost doom-like metal, noise rock, ambient sort of electronica, all over the place. And the whole thing was recorded at home on GarageBand, which is so lovely. Great album. One of the most beloved albums of the last 10 years, one of the most beloved hip-hop albums ever made, it is To Pimp a Butterfly by Kendrick Lamar. I can't remember if I talked about this on the MU video or not. I definitely talked about it on my video about my favorite albums of the 2010s. Kendrick, you know, at this point, a lot of people want to call him the best of all time. People want to call this album the best of all time in hip-hop. He is not my favorite of all time, nor is this my favorite hip-hop album of all time. But it is, like, very, 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 very good, and it is up there, seriously, for me. Kendrick is incredibly good, just incredibly, incredibly good, and I do think this is his best project, and it's cool. I think this album would appeal to a lot of people who maybe don't listen to a lot of hip-hop, or maybe haven't listened to a lot and don't like a lot of maybe more modern hip-hop, where this is taking a lot more inspiration from older hip-hop, 90s hip-hop, Tupac particularly. The original name of this album was To Pimp a Caterpillar, T-U-P-A-C. And a lot, there's, so most of the production and music on this is being handled by the team of Flying Lotus and Thundercat and Kamasi Washington, and who are all guys who are into, like, jazz, big jazz musicians. And this has a lot of like jazz, influenced live instrumentation, and just and a lot of love for like 70s P-funk. George Clinton appears on the opening track of this album, and just like a celebration of black music throughout the ages, really, is kind of how I feel like this album is. And it's a concept album that centers around a poem called To Pimp a Butterfly that is slowly revealed as the album progresses. He will read a little bit of it, and then sort of whatever the lines that he has ended on will tie into the theme of the following song, and then he'll come back and read all of it, but more. He'll keep going further and further until, as the album reaches its climax, he finally reads the entire piece, and it sort of serves as the thesis statement for the entire album, which is an album that's about the black experience in America, and you know, which is a really important thing that we talk about right now. It's something that's very on everyone's mind right now, and you know, this album predated the George Floyd murder and other things, but it did not predate many other notorious police executions that have happened. And it's really a powerful record. And I doubt that he will ever top it, but that's okay, you know. He's finally come back in the last few months. He had a couple features on his cousin's Baby Keem's record, and which is the first music he'd released in like 3 years, and they were very good and enjoyable, and something is in the works in the near future album, so I'm looking forward to it, and I'm sure it's going to be really good. Yeah, To Pimp a Butterfly, man.
You a hoe-ass nigga.
I don't know why you tryna go big, nigga. You ain't shit.
Walking around like you God's gift to earth. Nigga, you ain't shit.
You ain't even buy me no outfit for the fourth. I need that Brazilian wavy 28-inch. You playing?
I shouldn't be fucking with you anyway. I need a baller-ass, boss-ass nigga.
You's an off-brand-ass nigga. Everybody know it. Your homies know it. Everybody fucking know.
Fuck you, nigga. Don't call me no more.
You don't know. You gon' lose on a good bitch. My other nigga is on. You off. What the fuck is really going on?
This dick ain't free. You looking at me like it ain't a receipt, like I never made ends meet, eating your leftovers and raw meat. This dick ain't free. Living in captivity, raised my cap salary, celery, telling me green is all I need. Evidently, all I seen was spam and raw sardines.
Next is another one of my favorites of all time. It's up there in the all-timers. It is All Hail West Texas by the Mountain Goats, which is 14 songs about 7 people, 2 houses, a motorcycle, and a locked treatment facility for adolescent boys. This was released in 2002, and it was the final of what is referred to as the Mountain Goats' Boombox albums, which were albums that were recorded by John Darnielle just on a boombox at his house. Just him and an acoustic guitar recording on a boombox, and that is it. That is this album. It is a concept album about Texas. In the sense that all of the songs take place in Texas and are about people from Texas. So Mountain Goats are a band led by John Darnielle, who is the lead singer, guitar player, and principal songwriter, the only songwriter of the band, who have had a somewhat shifting lineup over the years, but it's pretty solid. And they have existed since the early 90s, and are still going to this day. John has also started publishing books. He's published two novels so far, which I loved both of. And he has his third novel is coming out in January, Devil's House. Very, very excited for that. I pre-ordered a signed copy of it when it was announced, so I'm looking forward to that. And so, you know, some of the greatest songwriting that has ever happened is happening on this record. You know, if you're a fan of the great classic American songwriters, Dylan, Leonard Cohen, Neil Young, I think you're going to find a lot to like here. Do not let the low fidelity home recording dissuade you from checking out this album. Also, it's worth noting that right now, as of early December 2000, or November, I'm sorry, getting ahead of myself, as of early November 2021, the Mountain Goats are going viral on TikTok right now with their song No Children, which is not on this album, it's on their album Tallahassee, which is a weird thing. It's a very weird song to go viral. It is one of their most popular songs, but it is this very brutal, nihilistic, and bitter song about a emotionally abusive relationship and divorce and hating the person you love, and it's a really intense song. So it's really weird that it's going viral on TikTok. But anyways, if you've heard that and you're intrigued and you don't know where to start, because there are a lot of Mountain Goats albums, I think this is the best one. I think it's a really good place to start. This has some of the best, you know, Mountain Goats songs on it. We start out with an all-timer, the best ever death metal band in Denton, which is a song about the story of two teenage boys, Silas and Jeff, who want to start a death metal band in the town of Denton, Texas, but one of their parents freaks out, satanic panic is happening, and he gets sent away to a locked facility for teenage boys, where they tell him he'll never be famous and all of these things. And man, there's so many good songs on this album. Jenny, that's one of my favorite songs just ever. It's a song that's a story, but it's just a moment. It's a song about a moment where the narrator pulls up on his new motorcycle into the driveway. Or, well, I suppose the narrator is Jenny. And so Jenny's partner, lover, whoever, pulls up with the motorcycle. And she hops on the back of the motorcycle, and then they speed away. And that's really the whole song. But, you know, it's like, there's so much about, like, the freedom of that moment of exhilaration, of getting away from your life. One of my all-time favorite lines ever in music: we pointed our headlamps toward the horizon. We were the one thing in the galaxy that God didn't have his eyes on. We've got a couple songs on here that were big, getting a lot of rotation when I was getting divorced. The Mess Inside, that's a really, really good one. That's sort of about remembering different moments in a relationship that has ended, and looking back on them, and the way that the context changes with the finality of the relationship. Another one of my all-time favorites, Jeff Davis County Blues, which is a song about a narrator getting out of jail and then just driving, not having anywhere to go, so he just drives all night. And someone out there actually mapped out the drive, because he specifically says, like, I go to this city and then I take this highway going this direction for this many miles and go to this other city. And it's a song about, you know, not having any place to be in a literal sense, but also in the sense of just feeling like you don't have a home or a place that you feel you belong, or people who you belong with, and it's a very relatable feeling. I think a lot of people have felt that way. I can't say enough good things about this album. It's just absolutely one of the best things that exists in the world, and you should listen to it.
You roared into the driveway of our Southwestern ranch style house on a new Kawasaki, all yellow and black, fresh out of the showroom. Our house faced west, so the big orange sun positioned at your back lit up your magnificent silhouette. How much better, how much better could my life get? 900 cubic centimeters of raw whining power. No outstanding warrants for my arrest. Whoa, 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 the pirate's life for me.
Next, I just mentioned him. When I was talking about the goats, it's Neil Young with Crazy Horse. Everybody knows this is Nowhere from 1969. So this isn't Neil's first solo album after Buffalo Springfield. It is the second. But most people kind of think of it like it's the first, because the first was self-titled 1968, and it's not great. It's not very good. And then he came out with this one with Crazy Horse. This was the first one with Crazy Horse. And this is just like an all-timer. This is just like a pinnacle of classic rock, 60s music. Just, man, is this a good album. I really love Neil Young. I also have sort of a special place in my heart for him because he's like my mom's favorite. So I have a lot of nostalgia for him because I grew up around his music a lot. But he is also just like an amazing and so this one, you know, this one's got like Cinnamon Girl and Down by the River and Cowgirl in the Sand, which are all like huge hits. Among his best known songs are all on here. And you know, Down by the River and Cowgirl in the Sand are also super long. Down by the River 9 minutes 13, Cowgirl in the Sand 10 minutes 3 seconds. And they have some pretty gnarly-ass guitar solos on them by Neil himself. So this is more... This is a Crazy Horse record, so this is more of like a rock record than some of his other, and maybe even more liked, records, like After the Gold Rush and Harvest, which were the two that immediately followed this record. Much more folk, acoustic albums than this one was. It's just really good, dude. It's so good. You know, it's dad rock, but it's like good dad rock, you know?
Be on my side, oh, be on your side, baby. There is no reason for you to hide. It's so hard for me staying here all alone.
Next, we have something that's become kind of a modern classic from 2006. It's Donuts, the final album by J. Dilla. I was a sophomore in high school when this album came out, and it was when I was that year that I first really got into underground music, and I was also getting into hip-hop, like, seriously, for the first time in my life. And so when this album came out, I scooped it up because it's on Stone's Throw, and I knew who J Dilla was. You know, he had done J-Lib with Madlib and other things. You know, he produced tracks on B by Common and a number of other albums. And I scooped this up. Well, I didn't buy it. You know, I pirated it because I was a teenager. And then he died a couple days after this album came out. And he actually, he made this album on his deathbed, literally. So I just checked so I could get all my dates and facts right. So this came out on February 7th, 2006, which was Dilla's 32nd birthday, and he died 3 days later, 3 days after his 32nd birthday. And he had a rare blood disease and lupus at the same time for the last, like, 3 or so years of his life. And so he first had a lot of weight loss, and then he ended up being confined to a wheelchair, and then spent the last year or so stretch of his life just in the hospital. And he made this record entirely using a SR-303 sampler and a stack of records. The whole thing is just crate digged like samples that he builds the songs out of. And it's an instrumental hip-hop album, and it's one of truly the best, like, pieces of hip-hop production. Really shows the potential of sampling, and really showcases how good Dilla was at doing it. And it does have that sort of sad sort of tinge to it, where it's a album being made by a dying man who knows he does not have much time left, who knows that this is the final statement that he will make as an artist. But one thing that I think is really cool about it is that it's not sad. It's not a morose thing. It feels almost like a celebration of the things that he loved, you know, the records and the music that he loved. And that's really cool. I really love that about this record. This is and it's funny because this is an album that Pitchfork has they got rid of their original review and re-reviewed it because they were wrong. They fucked up. They gave this like a 7.2 or 7.6, something like that. No best new music when this came out. And then, you know, 5 years later, deleted the review and reviewed some reissue version of it and gave it a perfect 10, so that people wouldn't know how stupid they were. And, but, you know, it's like Jonah Hill in Superbad said, people don't forget. Don't cry.
I'll show you how my voice has made an unbelievable thing good.
Oh, okay, Joy.
I can't stand to see you cry.
I can't stand to see you cry.
If tears
to see you cry.
I can't stand to see you cry, no.
Next up, we have the breakout second record by Canadian hardcore band Fucked Up. It is The Chemistry of Common Life from the year 2008. Fucked Up is a hardcore band, experimental hardcore, post-hardcore maybe, band that this album kind of hit big in a way that a lot of stuff of that genre doesn't. Crossed over into sort of the mainstream indie world in a way that a lot of stuff like this doesn't. It is a very, very good album, I have to say. I like Fucked Up quite a bit, though I haven't listened to anything they've done since Glass Boys, which was two albums after this, about 7 years ago. But the album that came after this, David Comes to Life, which was this double concept album, huge record, very good, and the one after that, also very good. This album is great, and it's got a bunch of like guest vocals on it, including one from the band Vivian Girls, who are a very good band. And yeah, if you're into hardcore and punk and experimental rock, you will enjoy this record, I think. Fucked Up are still around doing stuff all these years later. Good for them. First album that I ever heard that made me like really fall in love with music. The first band that I ever, not the first band that I ever said was my favorite band, but the first band that I like really felt like defined me when this album came out. And I had a hoodie. I got my first hoodie. It was a hoodie for this band. It was in the year 2001. I was in sixth grade. Third studio album by Tool. It's Lateralis. Let me show you really quick this guy. Because if you open him up, he's got that on the record. It's pretty fucking cool. And the other record's pretty similar. Picture discs. So, you know, Tool is a huge band. Most people know Tool. It's not, they're not like a unheard of underground band or whatever. They play stadiums and shit. But they are probably like the biggest prog band like in the world at this point. Doing proggy things. They're prog metal, right? So they are metal, but they are doing proggy stuff, weird time signatures, tempo changes, say time signature changes, etc., etc. Very long songs, technically complex, and I still love Tool. I do think this was probably the last good album they made. I didn't really care for 10,000 Days a whole lot. I know some people think it's decent, but I was pretty soft on it. And then the new one that came out, you know, like 2 years ago, after that long hiatus, I was also very soft on, even more so. It really felt like all of the window dressing, maybe, of what made Tool sound like Tool, but with none of the soul in the songs, I guess. But when you've been going for 30 years, you know, you're bound to run out of steam eventually, I think. But a lot of people think this is Tool's best album. It might be the Tooliest of Tool's albums. I might like Anima more. It's close, though, for sure. It's great, though. You should listen to it. It's very good. It is very good. I know that people who like Tool are very annoying. But it is really good. I promise it's really good. Next is another very, very popular band. It's Led Zeppelin by Led Zeppelin, 1969. So like many people, I got into Led Zeppelin when I was in middle school. When I first discovered dad rock. And I liked them, you know. But then I got real sick of them. And the thing that jumped the shark for me was when my middle school orchestra did a rendition of Stairway, and I had to play it so much, and I got real sick of it, and I just got real sick of Zeppelin, and just it was like, I don't want to ever listen to Led Zeppelin again. And then the thing that was funny, though, was that I really mostly was listening to Four, the fourth self-titled, which is their most popular album. And I never listened to the rest of them that much back then. But then, when I started dating my ex-wife in the early 2010s, she was a big Zeppelin fan. And her favorite Zeppelin album is Presence. She might be the only one in the whole world whose favorite Zeppelin album is Presence. But she loves that album. And spending time with her, dating her, getting to know her, I started listening to Zeppelin again, listening to other Zeppelin albums that I hadn't listened to as much. And Zeppelin is amazing, you know. I don't think that it's easy to argue with the fact that Zeppelin is really, really good. And the thing I think about Zeppelin is that I was listening to it wrong when I was a kid. Because to me, the power of Led Zeppelin, the thing that makes Led Zeppelin really good, is not Robert Plant and Jimmy Page. The reason Led Zeppelin is good is because of the rhythm section. It is because of John Paul Jones and John Bonham. And I really do think that John Bonham is one of the best drummers ever. And I think that ending Zeppelin when he died, absolutely the right choice. And I think that that is really highlighted by the first Led Zeppelin song. The first song on this album that started the band off, Good Times, Bad Times. The drumming on that song is like some of my favorite drumming ever. Where Bonham had heard a different song, I don't remember what song it was, that used double bass drums, which was a pretty innovative thing for the time. But he didn't know that they were using double bass drums. And so he basically, like, figured out, I don't know if he was the first person to ever do it, but he figured out how to do the heel-toe method for bass drums so that he could do those sort of syncopated, really fast kicks to mimic the sound of the double bass drum. But the way that he does it is, like, this sort of, like, weird, shuddery rhythm that's, like, kind of, like, off a little bit. And it's, like, I don't even know how to replicate that. I don't think, it's, I mean, man, it just sounds so good. And, like, I was, like, having, I really associate this album with when I worked at Barnes & Noble. And when I worked at Barnes & Noble, it was at this mall in this suburb called Edina, which is a really wealthy suburb. And it was at this mall called the Galleria, which was literally, like, a mall for rich people. It was, like, a mall of upper-class, like, stores for rich people that sold, like, custom cabinetry and, like, really expensive faucets and shit like that. And there was also Barnes & Noble in it. And I would park in their parking garage. And every day when I would get done with work and I would just be, like, so fucking angry and miserable, hating my life, I would put on Good Times, Bad Times, like, as loud as my stereo would go. And I had a two-door Honda Civic shit box car. Driver's window wouldn't work. I was smoking at the time still, so I would crack my sunroof, turn Good Times, Bad Times up as loud as I could, blasting cigs out the sunroof as I tore ass through this parking garage, just blasting Led Zeppelin. And that was how I rocketed my way out of work and just sort of celebrated my freedom every day. So I have that. I really strongly associate that that memory with this album. Let's do one more. We're ending with a good one. Another one of my absolute all-time favorite albums. It is I Can Hear the Heart Beating as One by Yola Tengo from 1997. This was Yola Tengo's eighth record. Yola Tengo are one of the, like, most legendary staples of independent rock music in America. Their first record, Ride the Tiger, came out in 1986, and 35 years later, they are still going strong. New Jersey's own, the lovely Yola Tengo. This is their most popular and well-liked album, and I think that that is the correct way to feel. They have many very good albums, but this is the best one. And this gets thrown around a lot as, you know, best albums of the 90s, best indie rock albums of the 90s, etc. Received a very high rating from Pitchfork and was on the very high on the Pitchfork albums of the 90s list, which is how I first found it when I first started getting into this kind of music when I first found Pitchfork when I was like 15. And I went and I bought this on CD back then and have loved it ever since. And so yeah, this album, you know, it's cool because it's a big album. It's like 70 minutes. And they do a ton of different stuff on here. You've got just the sort of straight up indie rock, almost singer-songwriter-y stuff like Autumn Sweater or Stockholm Syndrome. You've got like shoegaze anthems like Sugar Cube or Deeper Into Movies. You've got Moby Octopad early in the album, which is based around like a Burt Bacharach lick. Interesting. You've got a cover of the song Little Honda by the Beach Boys. You've got a Beach Boys cover. You've got like post-rock with songs like Green Arrow. You've got like weird experimental stuff like Spec Bebop, which is this like 10-minute long space rock jam. They really just run the gamut on this record, and it's just consistently, they just knock it out of the park over and over and over and over and over. And this is an album that has really stood the test of time with me, where I've been listening to it for 16 years, and I just keep liking it more and more and more as time goes by. And that's why I was so happy when I went to Extreme Noise, which is this collective-run punk rock record store in Minneapolis. And while they do in their new music pretty much only have like punk and metal, they do have a more wide variety in their used stuff. And behind the counter, up on the wall, they had this first pressing from 97 of this record for, I believe it was about $32. And this was just a couple years ago, maybe 2 years ago. And I was so excited that they had it, and I bought it immediately, no hesitation. Even though I usually don't buy records that are over 25, I love this album so much, and it was a first pressing, and I was like, that's worth it. That's just so cool. And I'm glad I did, because now it is selling for average 92, cheapest one on Discogs, 86. That's pretty high. So, I love this record a lot. This is just, you know, some good, tasty, independent rock and roll music for your ear holes. And you will not go wrong with this one. Fun. That was a good way to kill an hour. Thanks for watching, everybody. Hope you enjoyed it.